Wow. Hey, family, good morning, Dumelang San Bonani. I hope where you are right now, you are dancing to this beautiful song by Joyous Celebration, Uzuliphathe Kahle. How I so wish I was able to dance, but hey, like it's a little in our listeners at home, I don't have good moves, and I don't want to make myself a laughing stock on Facebook. We can see a number of people are tuning in. Greetings to all of you. We are Predestined Life Radio, and this morning, of course, you have tuned into a show that is called Bringing Hope with Clement TC Speaker. And I must say, I am excited about this interview that we're gonna have this day. You know, every Monday we bring you nothing but the best. So today we'll be speaking about starting small and finishing big. If you're writing, if you have a notepad, I want you to take notes, because this is not just gonna be a session where you will be entertained. You know, many people today, they consume entertainment a lot, and one thing that I know about entertainment is it doesn't grow us at all. So this is a session that is specifically designed and brought to you for your elevation, for your transformation, for illumination. Number of things are going to happen in your innermost being, mind, as you will be listening and engaging with us. And of course, we have a WhatsApp line. You can send your messages to 061-497-9952. That's our WhatsApp line, and we'll also be taking your calls during the course of the session. You can call us on 012-004-2025. 012-004-2025. Hey family, I must say I'm happy that finally this is happening. I've been actually anticipating this day for, I don't know, for how many years. I was telling one of our radio presenters before we started the show that Joyous Celebration, it is one of those choirs which their music drew me closer to the Lord. In the morning we were playing a song that says His Spirit is here, and there's a part where they say Yahuzumoya, and I will literally feel the Spirit of the Lord in my living room, worshiping God. If it was not of the contribution that Joyous Celebration made, some of us spiritually wouldn't be where we at. And I must say, we know Joyous Celebration, they do their music with excellence. There's a song that I used to listen to back then. And you know, if you want to know if the song is good or the singer is good, is when everybody who can sing, they just want to sing like that person. So there's a song that says, in the shadow of your wings. that's our song. I think it's also a generational song. That's how Joyous Celebration good they are. So today I have one of the co-founders in the studio, the man that I honor so much, the man that I respect. I was sharing with Coach before we even started, and I said, yo, you know, when I was doing my research, one of the things that I found out is that when you recorded your first project, I was 4 years old.
I'm a grown man. I'm old.
Yeah. So this man lived the life before I could even tell what life is. He already started living life. So I must say, today in the studio, we are graced and blessed to have in our midst the great wealth of wisdom. Because even from the biblical teachings, we get to learn that with age comes wisdom. And then also with experience comes wisdom. And then there are some things that when you engage with people who are your predecessors, it helps you to achieve things at a shorter space of time, actually it eliminates delay, if I may put it that way, simply because of you associate yourself with people who have experience that is greater than yours. So in the studio family, I am joined by the man, and before you be like, I can go there. Most of you, I know when you listen to his music, there's something about him. There's this confidence that becomes exuded time and again when he sings. You know, Motuali Shoka Tuyahai, like Tuyira, like you can tell that this person is really sure about his thing. So we are joined in the studio by the one and only. Let me do this before we can even go any further. We are joined in the studio by the one and only Ubaba Jabu Hlongwane. He's in the building. Say, how are you?
I'm all right. How are you?
I'm good.
Great.
I like how you said, all right. How are you?
I'm good. I'm all right.
I must say, I feel so much honored. Mm-hmm. That you chose to be with us today. And I think before we can even engage deeper in our conversation, before we went on air, we were speaking about, because today actually we will be speaking about starting small and finishing big. We were speaking about your belief in impacting a soul, even if it can be two people or 10 people. Why is that so important for you?
When God gives you an opportunity, mm-hmm, of an audience, even if it's an audience of one, those who are grown like me understand that You don't take it lightly, especially if somebody takes their time to listen to you. Mm-hmm. It's important for you to understand that it's God who has positioned that person in your presence, and honor that by attending to that person like you're attending to God himself. Mm. Whether it's a guy that works at the door or somebody you meet at the garage when you're pouring petrol. Mm-hmm. When they are given to you as an audience, it's important for you to honor them and understand that it's God who has given you that opportunity. Why is that? You do not have time in this life to know everything about everything that you need to know about. Mm-hmm. So God deposits pockets of nuggets of knowledge everywhere. Mm. And then as you walk like a guard of honor of things that people have that you need that you don't have. Mm. So from you today, my biggest thing is to pick up something. As I leave this place, I need to have picked up something from you.
Okay.
That would make me a better person. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's very important when I speak with somebody to not think that my job is just to speak, but to understand that I need also to listen and learn and pick up something from that person. Mm. One person is better even more than 1,000, because I'm able to speak and hear at the same time. Mm. When I speak to you, I'm also listening. But when it's crowds, I don't get anything really that much, except they're screaming when I'm performing or whatever. Mm. But when I sit with you like this, this is more important than the performance. Mm. I gain more here.
I hear you.
Yeah.
So before we can even jump to the next points, I believe I've learned a lot before we could even go on air. And
okay,
we need to do justice also to other people to know what we're actually speaking about. You raised something. You spoke about the importance of living intentional.
Yeah.
Being intentional about everything that, mm-hmm, you do. And you also spoke about time management, mm-hmm, and how if you waste, let's say, 50% of your time in a day, that means you have wasted 50% of your life. Mm-hmm. Please take us through that, because yeah, you said it better. I want you to say it again.
Somebody said, if you don't plan to succeed, you are planning to fail. The lack of the plan is a plan. So if you sit and have no plan, you are actually planning, but you're just planning to fail. So what I said off air was, living intentionally is to have a life that is intentional to an extent that you know by the end of this year what is it that you shall have achieved. It's better to plan to achieve something and fail,
okay,
than not to plan anything, you know, and feel like you have not failed. You failed before you planned. So the example I made was, if you ask a regular person, what did you do yesterday? And say, allocate per hour since you woke up yesterday in the morning. What did you do in the first hour? What did you do in the second hour until you go back to sleep? You find that half the time, the hours don't have anything because they don't know what they did in those hours. So if half the time you don't know what you were doing, it means you only lived intentionally half the day. So if you've lived intentionally half the day and that's your pattern, it means you are a person that lives half a life, which means when you are 30, you are actually 15.
And that's the point that I was waiting for.
And so that is why then when you look at your life, you feel like you've not achieved according to the time you've heard on this earth. Because you don't know what you did with the 15 years. You only can, talk about the 15 years that you did something that you can remember. Because if you live like that, you die with a life that has been wasted, because whatever that God, this is the thing, when God creates a person, he puts the purpose of the person inside the person, ne? He puts it in you, and then he wraps it up with time. So when the clock ticks, it ticks according to the germination and the growth of your purpose on the inside. So when the clock ticks, but you do nothing about what is on the inside of you, the clock moves faster than you. And by the time the clock stops, when you die, whatever was supposed to grow on the inside has not grown. Let me make an example, a quick one. A seed, this is in the book, a seed of a peach fruit. When you've eaten the peach, you throw the seed on the floor or in the dustbin. And then the dustbin is taken, it's thrown into the trash space, and the wind comes. And everybody, when you look at that seed, it's shriveled up, it's hard, it doesn't look good. But in that seed is another tree with leaves and branches and another seed and another fruit. The looks on the outside have nothing to do with what's on the inside. So when you see the seed on the road, you can kick it, and you don't see any value in it. So the problem with us, we look at ourselves from the outside. We look at, and in the mirror, you see whatever that you think you are and what people think you are. You are not on the outside. You are on the inside. What really is the person and his purpose is found on the inside. Now, when the seed gets into the drain, it's taken by water. It fell in Pretoria. It might be in Joburg, where it will find a nice little corner that is dark and has little moist. And then it cracks. And the giant that is on the inside, an amazing, powerful tree, begins to grow. And when that tree grows, imagine that tree growing next to a building. That building is going to crack. From a seed that was thrown away, taken by water into the drain, but as it rolls, it's the tree inside that is rolling. It's the roots, it's the branches, it's the leaves, it's another fruit and another number of seeds. It's got a number of seeds in there as it rolls. So that's how we are as people. So when you look at your life, you're thinking, I come from a single parent space. It means nothing. If a seed would say, no, I was thrown into a dustbin, so I can't achieve anything. No, you're not about the dustbin or the throwing. You're not about the single parent family, or even if your parent was raped, or even if you were raped. But what is on the inside has not been raped.
Yo.
Whatever, even we can't give excuses, say, no, we were, it was apartheid and all. No, we can't. We can't.
So what you're saying is there are no excuses when it comes to, I can't do this, I'm a failure because of this and this. What you're saying is there are no excuses in life.
Absolutely. There are no excuses. You can't be excused. When you stand before God, you won't have the luxury of saying, I did not become what I was supposed to be because I did not have a father. Mm. Or at home, they did not have money to take me to school. You don't have that kind of excuse. No. You have absolutely no excuse, because God is impeccable in terms of how he blends things. Wherever you find yourself right now, you are at the right place to become what you are supposed to be.
But Pastor, somebody will say to you, Mfundis, I hear you, but you don't understand my situation. You know there are those kind of people.
Yeah.
How do we help such people who say, I hear you, but you don't understand my situation, where I'm at, the family background, the house that I live in, and etc. How do we help such people?
They're making excuses. I don't have to understand your situation. God works from your situation. God takes you from wherever you are. It doesn't matter where you are. As long as you breathe, God will take you from there. And lead you to an amazing height of the fruition of your purpose. So you have not, because when you say you don't understand my situation, you are actually saying God does not understand your situation. Because you're not walking with me, you're walking with God. Of course I don't understand your situation. I don't have to understand your situation. The issue of life is between you and God, and not with other people. If I tell you that, from when I was born until I was around 10, the way we were poor at home, we were sleeping on the floor from when I was born until I was around 10. We were sleeping on the floor in Soweto. I was born and grew up in Soweto. My father would take cardboard boxes and put them on the floor. And my father was a policeman. He did not have money to buy blankets. He had these overcoats, zamapois. He would then put the cardboard boxes on the floor, and then we all lie down, and then he puts those overcoats on top of us. That's all. Listen to me. Our diet at home, Monday would eat pap and potatoes. Tuesday would eat potatoes and pap. Wednesday would have mixed pap and potatoes. Thursday would take potatoes and make them chips and eat pap. And then on Friday, we'd have cabbage. Potatoes and pap. Friday was an amazing time because there's going to be cabbage. Chicken, we only had chicken at Christmas.
Once a year.
My father would buy a live chicken. Me and my brother would not go to play. We'd sit and watch it because we don't want anything to happen to this thing. Because if somebody steals it or the dog takes it or whatever, we have to wait for another Christmas.
Yo.
We were so poor that I could not afford books to go to school. We were so poor that for shoes, I took cardboard boxes, ne? You took cardboard box, you put it like this, and then you cut it around your foot, ne? So you put your foot there, and then you take maybe a string. You tie a string on top of your foot so that the cardboard box becomes the sole of your foot. That's the shoes I had going to school. That children would laugh at me, you know. It was terrible. But I'm here now. I can't go to God and say, God, no, we didn't have shoes, or my father did not have. Listen, he did not have money to buy books for me or for us, all of us. This is what I did. When the school starts, there are children who had books. I would borrow their books, go read it and finish it, and take it back. Read it and finish it. All the books that I had for all the courses, for all the subjects. By the time the teachers start to teach, I know everything they are talking about.
So indirectly, your circumstance worked in your favor.
They thought I was bright. No, we did not have money. I was not clever. We just were poor. So I took poverty and worked. When the Bible says it all works together for the good,
okay,
I
sir.
Took poverty to say I don't have books, and my father will not buy books for me. Other kids had books. I said, please borrow me a book. It's the beginning of the year. Things are still casual. Things have not started. Take that book. I would take somebody's book and read it one night.
Yo.
One night, read the book.
So I think even what you're saying right now, this year due to COVID-19, I went to one school. Some learners said to me, because of lockdown, our academic year, actually, we couldn't do things on time, this and this. And they were saying, no, we even think or feel that we're going to fail this and this and that.
It's just excuses. It's excuses. And that's what kills black people. Because you don't hear that nonsense from white people. White people are quiet. They are working. They are going to pass. Why? Because they've learned, unfortunately, they've learned that there's no excuse. Because the people who have excuses have books, they have internet, they have all kinds of things. They can get umsebenzi from a school and work at home. What are they doing? Loitering in the township. It's excuses. Lockdown is not an excuse not to achieve what you're supposed to achieve.
Yo.
Absolutely. So if we keep on doing what we are doing and thinking like we are thinking, we will be here 20 years later. We'll be sitting where you are 20 years later. And that is why that we I hope God helps us at some stage. We as Africans, because you don't find Indians doing and doing all kinds of stuff. They have things they don't like now. But they don't do it. They sit down and plan. When something is uncomfortable, they plan. When Standard Bank is doing, for instance, if Clicks is doing something negative or doing what they've done about black hair, Indians would sit together and plan how to buy Clicks. They put money together.
Yeah.
Put money together. Before you know it, Clicks does not have the owners. Mm. The owners are gone. It's Indians who own that. So they put their things there. Because you can't depend on other people to define you. You can't say, Clicks says this about us. Clicks says that about us because we can't define ourselves.
Yo.
We do not define ourselves. We can't say Clicks says our hair is this or our hair is that. And we try to doy against that, wearing weaves. It doesn't make sense. Of course we do not have a definition of our hair. Because this weave thing and other... I'm sorry, I didn't check if they got them. Because you are saying...
They're saying forgive it.
Thank you. Because if I don't like what they are saying, they are saying that because I have not defined myself.
Okay. So... what you're simply meaning is that people will always have an opinion about you if you haven't come to a place where you've defined yourself.
Jesus comes to the synagogue. He says, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life.
Okay.
And they're like, but what is this child talking about? You understand? You talked before that when I get on stage, I look like I know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Of course I know.
Yeah.
Of course I know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
The extent of my knowing what I'm doing has to do with me knowing I have stature, I'm tall. I have a body.
Okay.
I have the voice.
Yes.
I have a presence.
Okay.
When I walk by, you will notice me.
Okay.
It's not arrogance. it's the level at which you need to know yourself.
Yeah. And use that.
Because when I get on stage, everybody is here.
Okay.
You understand?
Sure.
And when I do my thing, they know this thing is good.
I also know that this thing is good.
Because you look good.
Yeah.
You present good.
Okay.
But half the work is done already. They know, they expect that it's going to be good. Now, the problem, even with ladies, our girls, they do not know themselves. So when a guy comes and says, hey, lumtana lo muhle ini, it's the first time they hear about that. At home, they can't define themselves and say, I am beautiful. I tell my daughter those things. My daughter would come into my bedroom and look herself in the mirror and say, I'm beautiful. I'm like, yes, baby, you are.
Yes.
She needs to know that. She needs to know she's beautiful. She is powerful. God has an amazing future for her. You need to know. But if you don't know those things, you don't talk about those things to yourself, people will define you. And you get offended when people define you Because you see, when you say, for instance, to a white person, when you say to us, you are inferior, a white person would laugh at you.
Mm.
Because they have told themselves that they are not inferior. So when a white person says to a black person, you are inferior, you get irritated and you get emotional. Why? Because you suspect that they're telling the truth. Because you don't know that you are not inferior.
So our response actually to criticism, racism, and etc., we respond from the basis of self-affirmations that we have made upon ourselves.
Nobody can no one can oppress you without your permission.
Yeah.
No one.
So we actually give them permission.
We did. You can't tell me when white people came into this country hundreds of years ago, they still are in charge. And they are less than 20%. You can't blame white people.
Mm.
They found a country lying around with no one. They took it. They're still controlling it. Forget the president, the ANC, and all the nonsense we are doing, toy-toying, burning things, and protesting, and whatever. That's a waste of time, I promise you. We can go and lock up cliques. Tomorrow we'll be locking up Kentucky Fried Chicken. Tomorrow, that's all we'll be doing. White people will be running this country.
So somebody will say, as they hear you speak, but what do you think the solution to this situation can be? On a larger scale, of course.
Simple. I like it when you ask it like that. Anything that has been introduced through a system,
okay,
cannot be fixed without a system.
Yeah.
So the system that is in place now has been introduced through a system. What we are doing as black people, we're dealing with events and we're not touching the system. The reason why they killed Steve Biko quickly is because he was speaking what I'm talking about. To say black people, it's not about events. It's about the system. Change the way you think about yourself. For instance, if you do what we are doing, we protest and make noise about cliques. Next week we'll be forgetting about cliques. But cliques will be there.
And the owners will continue to
will be
to
buying buy. From cliques. And the owners
the very
of
same
cliques,
hair product.
Yes. The owners of cliques will make money. You understand? Even if we ban cliques, they have insurance.
So we are not actually touching.
You're
them.
Not doing anything. It's like trying to wipe the water from the floor instead of switching off the tap.
Yeah.
So our we are reactionary. So now we're like, oh yeah, no, it's fine. We're talking, things are normal. And then we hear some event of racism. Hey. 2 weeks, it's done. And because when it's quiet and cliques is not saying anything about black hair and stuff, it doesn't mean that racism is not there. Racism is still there. It's hidden in the system. So we need a system to deal with racism, because racism is a system. That is why it was introduced through education, through television, through even inkolo, the faith. As Christians, there's a lot of racism in there. Every aspect, education. I mean, we learned some stupid things. We were learning about the locust. And we what are we doing with the locust? What is that thing going to... When they teach mathematics, they'd be like, when you have six apples and you eat three, how many are left? They're teaching us to be consumers. To eat three. That is why we can't be producers. We are consumers. Because we have been taught... It's a subtle message that they put in education. They put it in religion. They put it everywhere. It's a system. We need to create a system. A system that will say, for instance, on television, I love it in other countries, the way the leaders and the government runs. When you go to Dubai, you will not find, for instance, pornography.
In Dubai, there's no pornography.
No, even if you like, you will not find it. The government has closed it down at internet level.
So the government has capacity to close those sites?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. In Dubai, you can't be a citizen. You come from another country and be a citizen there. In Dubai, you can't as a guy come in and talk to a lady from Dubai and propose and have a relationship with them. You can't. It's not permitted. Now, the problem with us as black people in charge, everything is permitted. Foreigners coming to South Africa and buy the country piece by piece. Our children will not have a country. They will rent the country from foreigners. Foreigners from Zimbabwe, from everywhere, from Europe. They buy the country piece by piece because the government has no resolve in terms of putting in systems. Systems that say, on TV, we will not show this type. For instance, we talk about gender-based violence. But we allow videos of naked women dancing in hip-hop songs and stuff. Women become objects, sexual objects in movies, in music videos and stuff. And we say we're fighting gender-based violence. And when we respond to that, it's when somebody has been killed. That's an event. We're not dealing with the system. A system should talk about magazines, for instance. In magazines are not allowed to show women as sexual objects.
Okay.
Television is not supposed. Everything, it has to be a system. Everywhere, education, enkolweni, in churches, everywhere. Women should be presented as equals, as people. And them themselves, women do this. They know how they provoke the sexual thing, even the way they dress and they pushing that thing. It's important for us. That is why when you go to places like Dubai, women are dressed. They are covered. It's a law. You cover. So no one will rape in Dubai. You can't rape. It's impossible for you to rape in Dubai. Because television does not present people as sexual objects. Women are people. So we need a government that would be that intentional in terms of dealing with issues.
Okay.
For instance, when you talk about cliques, what are they? Cliques is not a South African entity. What are the contracts saying about cliques? What is cliques contributing towards this country? What is all the other companies that are coming in? What is their contribution towards building our country? Except just selling stuff. No. You want to start a company, start a company. Here's a land. When to start this, start it. Everybody comes and they do whatever. Going down even to the ships with the spaza shops and stuff. You can't have a Somalian coming all the way from Somalia and owning a shop in Soshanguve. You will not go to Nigeria, for instance, and open a spaza shop. You will not. You won't. There's no foreigner who has a shop in Nigeria. You can't have a spaza shop in Nigeria because they have a system.
So, but what's the problem with South Africa?
We don't have any agenda. The agenda in leadership, political parties, and in leadership is a personal agenda of making as much money as possible for me and my cronies.
And so the drive is money.
No, it's money. It's money. I just saw something on the internet that there's a school that does not have classrooms. Little children are studying under the tree in 2020. We have a minister of higher education, lower education, middle education, all these ministers. But there's a school where they don't have an agenda for that. They have an agenda to tick the boxes. That is why right now we have a pass rate, a pass mark of 30%. The whole doctor who runs the education system allows for a system that says when you got 30%, you can pass. Who wants to go to a doctor who passed his doctorate at 30%?
And if even that percentage, when you go to university, you'll never get that.
You won't. And the minister doesn't care about that. He won't be. But their kids, that's the thing. They won't take their kids to those schools. They will take their kids to international schools who want 100% pass mark. And they put a law for our kids to say it's 30%. They don't care about us. We don't have leadership that cares about people, that has an agenda about people. This is the thing. When you are a leader and you do everything for you and your family and your cronies, it's a problem for the people you are leading. Because as a leader, you're supposed to create a legacy. It means when you plan now, you need to plan for 50 years or 20 years at least. When you build a structure, if you go here in Pretoria, Union Buildings, how long ago was that thing built? That thing is working today.
And it's still there.
You go to SABC. How long ago was that built? It's still working. But the things we build as black people, they fall 2 years down the line, 3 years down, because we're not believing in legacies. We want to do something that will benefit me now. If there's a budget, I need to eat from that budget, and my friends, whatever is left, can do whatever that needs to be done. Look at the Prasa thing, the trains in Prasa. It's crazy. So we don't have an agenda as black people. Everybody wants to eat as much as possible before I go.
Mm.
And others are waiting in line to come in and eat as much as possible. And then at the end of the day, we have commission after commission, just like this waste of time of Zondo Commission. That's a waste of time. Because we see that they're spending millions. And they're saying, so-and-so did this, so-and-so do. Nobody's arrested, and that money doesn't come back. Why are we doing it? It's a waste of time. There's money that should go and build that school that I'm talking about. But that money is spent on a Zondo Commission that is chowing money and doing nothing for us. That's my problem.
Okay, before we take a song, as a qualified teacher, I want to ask you a question as a qualified teacher. Many people don't even know that you are a qualified teacher.
Yeah.
Of course, you taught English.
Yeah.
You are also correcting my English while I'm speaking.
I don't.
That's what teachers do. I'm like, you should have said it this way. Yeah. Okay, but I once read about Desmond Tutu, as a teacher, he was a teacher as well, and when he was busy teaching, one of the things that he discovered during that period of Bantu education is that the educational system of Bantu was designed to destroy the black people, and then as a result, he resigned from his position. And then now, people have been speaking about decolonizing the curriculum or decolonizing education. And from your assessment as a professional in that space, what can you say about the educational system of 2020?
It's a sad type of education. It's sad and it's worse. Bantu education was better. You know what they try to do? They go overseas and they check education in this country, they want to come and plant it here, and it kind of doesn't work. They go to another country, they plant it here. It's a series of those things. When I was still in the education space, there was OBE, outcome-based education. They come here, and they train teachers, and they put them there to do this, and it doesn't work. They change it. Now, I don't know from when we took over until now, how many things have been changed. We're shifting everything. We shift so many things, including the pass mark, including how the students are supposed to be treated in terms of the content, in terms of it's in shambles, because everybody that comes in as a minister wants to change things. We don't believe in legacies, you understand? And when we moved from Bantu education, we wanted to jump and move into a new thing. When Bantu education has been a system that is scientific, that they spent time designing and put it in place and let it run smoothly. And when we come, we don't want to use a system that is scientifically put together. We just want to dismantle this and put something that we stole from another country. It won't work. We need to take our time. For instance, we rush into things. We want to change the name of Pretoria to Tswane. How much money are we spending to change that? It does not make a difference to somebody's life. Umama who's in social welfare section, bani, that does not make any difference in that person's life. It's a waste of time. They need to sit and devise a system. A system, when it gets into operation, it gets into everything, education, the names of the town, the budgets. They can't just wake up in the morning. It's like the ministers wake up in the morning. No, this department is not going to call arts and culture. It's going to catch arts and culture and sports and and parks and whatever. The next thing, no, it's not going to be called that. It's going to be arts and culture and museum. No, every minister that comes, they change things. So if you change things like that, you can't monitor things, you can't measure things, you can't see the development, you can't see the impact you're making.
Mm.
Because it's up and down. This time, the minister of police, next time you're a minister of transport. The other time you're a minister of
just the reshuffle.
It's crazy.
Mm.
It's madness. We will not get it anywhere as black people if we don't have systems, if we don't believe in a system.
Mm.
It's important for you as a nation to have an agenda, to have a system.
Mm. Mm.
Without being apologetic.
Mm.
We need to get to that space without being apologetic. That's a problem. And I like what you say. I want to go back to what you said when you started. You say I'm a teacher.
Mm.
And I'm possibly correcting your English. I was a communication science major. I majored with communication science at university.
Mm.
English is not our language, and we don't need to respect it.
Mm.
I would have a problem if you can't speak your own language.
Okay.
But if you speak English and break it, it's fine by me.
Okay.
It's not your language, and you don't owe English a respect.
Mm.
It's not your language. It was forced on you. Number one. Number two, the intention of communication is for me to hear what you're saying.
Okay.
And you hearing what I'm saying. It doesn't matter if it's broken.
Mm. Mm.
As long as I hear what you're saying and you hear what I'm saying, that's it. We can, if you can even use your hands and do sign language. As long as we communication, that's the biggest thing. So sometimes we worry ourselves. I watch TV and see somebody trying to say something important. And they're trying to fiddle with English. They don't know. And you end up not knowing what they're saying.
Mm.
They should be speaking in their Shangaan or in their Venda or in their Zulu.
Mm.
But they want to speak English. So it's a mentality.
Mm.
Because the system has not been rectified.
Mm.
Because when they ask you a question from TV, then you respond from an inferior space of saying, mina as a black person, I have a language that is not valid.
Mm.
So I'm going to use a language that I don't know to express myself. You can never express yourself as an African efficiently in a foreign language.
Mm.
It takes a lot in order for you to reach that.
Mm.
It takes a lot to think in English. Because when you speak, you have to think and then turn that into words.
Mm.
When they come out of your mouth, it's the thinking and the conversion and then the speaking. So if you're thinking in Shangaan, but you have to speak in English, you think in Shangaan, and there has to be a process.
Mm.
And it's slow.
Mm. Mm.
So it takes time to make it flow.
Mm.
Why do you put yourself through that? It's because in your mind you're thinking your language is not valid. You have to use another person's language.
Mm. Family, yeah. Our time now, it is 10 minutes past 11. We are left with, if I'm right, 40 minutes before we can even wrap up our show, our session. How I so wish we had 10 hours. Yo. I'm going to take a song now, and I think it will be best during the course of the song, as we will be playing it, those who want to call, I'm giving you an opportunity to interrupt the song. Ne? You can call us on 012-004-2025. The pastor is in the building. He's going to answer your question. If you have a question, call us on 012-004-2025. 012-004-2025. The next song that I'm going to play, it is by Joyous Celebration, Abazohamba. The man who sings this song is a man who exudes confidence. You'll get to know about him when we come back.
Ivangeli Zohamba,
Ivangeli
Zohamba,
Ivangeli
Zohamba. It's Pretty Stand Live Radio, the station that brings hope to the hopeless.
Welcome.
Listen live now on www.prettystandlive.online.
Are you ready? Welcome.
We are back at it, family. We are still continuing with our guest in the studio. We are joined by Pastor Jabu Hlongwane. He's in the building, and I must say I am learning a lot from this conversation that we are having today. Actually, I must add to that it is going beyond my expectations. I think personally, so I feel more empowered. I feel more charged. Have you ever been in a place, family, where you feel like you are commanded that go and do this, and when you do it, I want you to do it right this time? That's where I'm at right now. That's how I feel right now as I continue to engage in this conversation. The song that we've just played right now, it is Joyous Celebration, Abazohamba. Hey, I love this song. You know, at churches, now before lockdown, nobody is in this, or Zenz and Jane will come. Even when we don't know how to dance, they'll just be like this on our chest, you know. And I must also add to that and say, if it was not of Joyous Celebration, most of the songs that keep our churches in this, like the vibe move, dancing and stuff, we have to confess in South Africa, but we have to admit somehow that if it was not of Joyous Celebration, our churches, most of them, they wouldn't be having a vibe that they have today. Niti Ninina at home, family. You can send your WhatsApp, your voice note to 066-464-5762. Send your voice notes on our WhatsApp line. It's 066-464-5762. We are Predestined Live Radio, the station that you love, of course. Now we are continuing. We are speaking today about starting small and finishing big. And Pastor Jabu Hlongwane said something of which when he said it, I was like, I agree on that one. He said, in life, we don't have excuses. Many people, they say, I can't start a business simply because of I don't have funding.
Mm.
And that story is popular in the black society.
Yeah.
I need funding to start my business. No funding, I won't start. Mm-hmm. Some people will say, I want to start an organization. If I don't have money to, somebody once said to me, I don't have money to brand t-shirts. I need merchandise for my organization. I need banners, and et cetera. Mm-hmm. Without this, I won't start. We were, I think in so many ways, we were given reasons and also taught why we can't.
Mm-hmm.
And then a less has been done on why we can.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a scripture, one preacher once said, it says, there is nothing impossible with God.
Mm-hmm.
And the preacher elaborated it this way. He says, it doesn't say there is nothing impossible for God,
mm-hmm.
but with God.
Mm-hmm.
When you are with Him,
mm-hmm.
things begin to be possible.
Mm-hmm.
Before we can even speak about the formation of joyous celebration, you spoke about purpose before we went to an outbreak earlier when we started. You spoke about purpose, how it's wrapped up in you along with time.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's, of course, a great dialogue when it comes to how one can discover their purpose.
Mm-hmm.
There's that dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
Even when we can go to YouTube, search how to discover your purpose, you'll be shocked.
Mm-hmm.
Thousands and thousands of presentations were made mm-hmm. when it comes to how to discover your purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Even on Google, such is still happening. Even today mm-hmm. at churches, we host conferences, especially for young people in mm-hmm. particular,
mm-hmm.
how to discover your purpose.
Mm-hmm.
So somebody, of course, was listening. They're like, okay, I hear you, but I'm still in that space. I don't know how to discover my purpose. You also spoke about your background, how you grew up without a bed and without shoes to school, you know. But still you managed to defeat all those circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
And you are where you are right now at the stage of your life. So take us through about, speak to us about how to discover your purpose.
Well, when you say, when you Google, you find hundreds and thousands of presentations on how to discover your purpose. But around you and the people you know, how many people do you know who have discovered their purpose? When there's hundreds and hundreds of presentations about that, but the number of people that actually do discover is not balancing with that. The information is out there, but the people want to sit and listen to information and do nothing. That's the biggest thing. Né? What do you do where you are with what you have? If you can answer that, what do you do where you are with what you have? It means you need to check, where are you?
Okay.
First,
mm-hmm.
what do you have?
To the part, what do you have? What you're saying is that all of us, we have something.
Oh, Lord. Something amazing. Nobody has nothing. God is not stupid.
Mm.
God cannot create a person and give them nothing.
Mm.
God will not allow you to be on this earth and give you nothing. It's just that what you have, we're in your time, you don't think it's something of value, because you look at other people and you see what they have when they have worked at it.
Okay. So I like the part worked at
it. Yes. So you see it where it has blossomed.
Okay.
You don't see it when it started. So you have the start of what you have. You want to compare it with the one that has blossomed. So you think what you should have should come blossomed already.
Mm.
So when you see others blossoming and going places, you feel mine means nothing.
Mm.
But if you follow the stories of everybody that has their thing blossomed, you find that what they had was even not as big as what you have.
Mm.
But everybody has something.
Everybody has
something. So you need to work with that. What do you do with wherever you are with what you have? Because everybody has something. Now, this is the thing. People are lazy to work at it. There's a section in my book that talks about that.
Mm-hmm.
Working at it.
Mm.
Your purpose, what you are created for, is what will not go away.
Mm.
Something in you that will not go away.
Okay.
You will go do this. That is why a whole lot of people start going to school and study, and they get to study. Maybe others, like as a doctor, like Dr. Toomey.
Mm.
But what will not go away from Dr. Toomey is the music.
Okay.
And what has thrown him into the limelight is what?
Music.
What will make him more money is?
Music.
So everybody has something that will make you more money.
Okay.
That will throw you into a limelight.
Yo.
But what you have studied is not necessarily that.
Okay.
Because what you have as your purpose, you don't need to study for it.
Yo.
Right now, my life is sustained through music.
Mm.
I studied education with majors in English and communication science. That's what I studied at university.
Mm.
That's what I went and taught.
Mm.
But music would not go away.
Mm.
I never studied a day in music. I've never been in a class of music, not one day.
Mm.
But I'm able to teach people who went to school. I was teaching one guy who has a degree in music and a senior degree in music, teaching them how to write a chorus.
Yeah.
Because sometimes education kills what you have. When you go to education, they teach you based on books of people who have died 100 years ago.
Mm.
They tell you to do something in 2020 based on the knowledge that is limited that they had 20 years ago. So you take that and you kill what you have now in 2020 with information that was released 20 years ago by a guy who is dead already.
Mm.
When they teach about songwriting in music, they will teach you about Handel, Mendelssohn, whoever.
Mm.
And they talk about how the structure of the song is, you know, the introduction, the verse, and the chorus, verse, maybe a bridge. And then you come back to the chorus and da-da-da-da. They teach you those things.
Mm.
And you find Africans in our villages. We sing songs that don't have a verse and a chorus and a bridge.
Mm.
We just sing. And it works.
Mm.
Jerusalem, ikhaya lami. Everybody in the world is singing that. And that thing, number one, the meaning of the song is dizzy.
Mm.
It doesn't make sense. It has no verse, chorus, bridge and stuff. It does not have that structure. So when you come from education, it's learning music at university, it makes you dizzy. No. You start criticizing. No, this doesn't make sense. Zahara came with a song. Uloliwe. Why do you la? Who is Loliwe? What is he doing? It doesn't make sense. But we sing it. That's music.
Okay.
Because in Zahara, music was the thing she could not resist. That won't go away.
Mm.
So that's the thing. When it's like that, you will do things. That is what I'm saying. You don't need money.
Mm,
Money needs you.
Mm. Okay, please break that one down. I'm busy saying, but I think I'm missing something. Okay,
when you have aligned yourself with what God has given and put in you, money comes running.
Okay,
you don't go looking for money. Money comes to you. Money needs you.
Mm.
I look at Maskandi musicians in KZN.
Mm.
They picked up a guitar at some stage. The way they play is not the way the guitar was supposed to be played in the first place. And others, they take the guitar and turn it up because maybe they use a left hand. And then in Zulu, we are skulumisa, it's king, ne? They will make the guitar speak. No, they don't know chords, if it's chord C or chord, they don't care.
They
will make
things.
This thing speak because it's in here. So music is an interpretation of what you're hearing here on the inside.
Mm.
Whether it's music or business or whatever. There are people, there's a guy who used to be a mechanic where in the township in Richards Bay.
Mm.
Never went to school for fixing cars. Mm. When you bring your car to that guy, he says, okay, I wait to miss. Start the car. And then he looks that like that. He looks away like that. Then you start the car and says, nah, a carburetor.
With ugly the sound.
He never went to school. So people who went to study mechanics at school, you bring your car, they bring the machines.
They have to diagnose.
They connect, they diagnose, they write down. The guy is done. He knows it's a carburetor. So there is something in you that connects with something on the outside.
Okay.
And God does this. It builds up. You'll find this in the book. Jesus was brought into this earth to introduce the kingdom of God. But the signature and the rubber stamp of the introduction of the kingdom of God was actually at the cross. His mission was to be, if Jesus was not nailed to the cross, we would not be Christians now. Because his nailing to the cross symbolized nailing our sins to the cross and him dying and rising again. The cross which means the wood and the nails are the heartbeat of what he was called for.
Mm.
But God organized that Jesus gets born in a family of a carpenter.
Okay.
So that he is introduced to wood and nails.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine his father saying, Jesus, bring, let a little plan alone. And Jesus is carrying the plan. I just seen the plan. But God is training him to carry the cross with those little planks and boards and stuff. And bring those nails. He brings the nails, maybe the amhlaba as he goes along. He is being trained so that in his destiny, when the cross is introduced and the nails are introduced, he's not scared of that. He knows that. Immediately before that, he says, I am about to be crucified. Mm. He knows it's going to happen, but he was introduced to him when he was a boy, like Moses lying in a basket.
Mm.
He's introduced to the DNA of the water.
Mm.
So when he's running away with the Israelites, he knows water. That is why he puts the stick and the water separates. It's something he was introduced to when he was a little baby. So in your life, whether it's a tragic situation, single mother's space, or you were thrown away when you were born and stuff, there lies seeds of your destiny. So if you are careful, you will respect and embrace your space where you are. That's what I'm talking about. What do you have where you are? Mm. Because where you are lies the seeds of your destiny.
Mm.
Pay attention, embrace where you are. Now, the thing is this. A lot of people curse where they are. That now I come from a poor family. Now I come from da da da. Right now, I don't have anything. Like you say, people will make all kinds of excuses. Mm. I have money.
Mm. Mm.
They're looking down on the idea.
Mm.
If you make a business idea irresistible, money comes running.
Mm.
So people cook a little quickly put together kind of business idea.
Mm.
And they want money to implement that. Nobody needs money.
Okay.
Money is available to everyone. That is why I tell Christians, don't pray for money. You don't pray for money. You don't pray for a house. You don't pray for a car. Those things have been given by God to anybody who, even people who are not Christian, they have access to those things. If a person who does not know God, who's not a Christian, has access to cars and money and stuff, how much more do you think you have to pray and ask your Father who gives these things to give you when he has made them available? In heaven, there are no cupboards that are locked waiting for you to pray so that he can take out things and give to you. They are given. The book of Peter, he says he has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness. They are given. Mm. We just need to know how to get them.
Okay.
It's like,
so power lies in knowing how to get them.
My people perish because of the lack of
knowledge.
You understand? Yeah. So if you meet somebody that has a radio thing going on like this, I can't go and pray that I have a radio thing. I just have to ask you.
Okay.
How did you do this? You understand?
Now
this predestined, imagine this, a building with a big writing on it at the entrance.
Okay, I'm imagining it now.
Predestined empire.
Okay.
It's a building.
Mm-hmm.
It's got radio. It's got TV.
Okay.
It's got print.
Yes.
It's got a graphics.
Okay.
It's got everything.
Yes.
You are the guy.
Mm.
This is not too far. So where we are right now, this is a small room.
Mm.
But here, it's got a seed for that huge building that I'm talking about. Mm. No one can stop you from that. No one.
Okay.
It's only you who can stop yourself from there.
Okay.
You just have to see it and work at it. That's another thing. Work at it. What is it that you are doing in working it? That's the thing. Our enemy is the small successes. You understand? Mm. We like, no, my name is Clement. You know, I have a radio station. So I'm the first black guy in Pretoria to have a radio station, you know. And, you know, we broadcast to so many people, you know. I'm the guy. We sit in that success.
Mm.
But that success is like a step that you need to move to another one. So when you enjoy the success, do you know Joyous? Yeah, no, I'm the guy, you know. So you sit in that success.
when God has planned for you to go further.
God told me this. God says to me, I did not call you for music. And he tells me that when musically, I'm doing okay. You know, money is happening, gigs, sales, and I'm like, I'm a musician. And God says, I did not call you for music. And our problem is that we define ourselves with the small successes and define ourselves. When you define yourself, you lock yourself up in that space and you can't come out and go to a higher space. So if you say, I'm a musician, God cannot use you anywhere else.
So the day you start labeling yourself is the day you start limiting yourself.
Label and limit. It's important for you to understand that God exposes you to all these spaces in order for you to master those spaces on your way to your destiny. Imagine Jesus Christ walks on water and then he starts to establish himself as a water wonder maker, prints business cards and say, you know, if you go water, I'm the guy. He raises somebody from the dead. He says, where are the mortuaries? I'm specializing in. And then he sits on that and he says, I'm the first guy that organized people to rise on. He sits there. The cross is waiting for him. So when you start to define yourself with these little successes, your cross, your glory, your seat of glory will be vacant. And when you stand before God, you can't say, no, I'm the guy that had a radio station in Pretoria. And God says, what? I created you fearfully and wonderfully just for the radio. You must be crazy. What you're supposed to move to is what nobody else can do. That is why we have fingerprint that is uniquely yours.
Okay. What you must move to isn't something that nobody else can do.
Oh, yeah.
So if you're doing something that others can do, you haven't...
You have not started. You understand? If what you do is what others can do and what others are doing, you have not started.
I feel like running away now.
Well, because this is a thing. This is a book, this is a cup, this is a bottle. When you go into your house, in the drawer, there are teaspoons and knives and forks and spoons. So the fork will sit there and wait for the time when the fork is called. So the thing is, the fork cannot start to act like a knife just because at this time, knives are called. Knowing yourself should go to an extent that when others succeed now, you see others doing great things, it doesn't bother you. Because you know who you are, and the time will come when you will be called, and when you are called, others will be sitting down and doing nothing. That's the level
of
knowing.
So it's a cycle.
It's a cycle. Now we become jealous, you know, especially in the music industry. So and so has got a hit song. So and so is. Then you become jealous because you want to be like them. And maybe you're not. There are people who are not called to do hit songs.
So somebody can be called for that.
There are people who have an anointing of a hit songs, of a hit song, and others have a hit song, one hit song in their lifetime. That's what their journey is. So if you look at others and want to be like them, you will want to be like 100 people and end up not knowing yourself. It's important to know yourself so well that nothing and no one can define you. Now, that makes you to start small, as you talk about starting small. People want to start big. I talk to young people like, oh, we want to get into the music industry. Okay, how long ago when you started music? He said, no, we started 2 years ago. And yeah, we want to go big. And you know, they're wearing t-shirts that are branded. That's another thing. People are obsessed with branding. Branding is not an issue. Don't rush into branding. Let the content brand you. That is why the iPhone...
So branding comes from the content.
Yes. The iPhone does not even advertise itself. iPhone does not advertise. They just put content and tell you we are releasing iPhone 7. People go sleep there because they know the content. So they are releasing a new iPhone. iPhone is very expensive. But people will queue up and go buy the latest. I mean, the latest iPhone is going for about 30,000.
Yo.
People go and buy that because they know the content, the capability of this thing. Now, people come with no content and start branding. You release a song says, King Wanahao, Then you have t-shirts written Kingwana How and caps that written Kingwana How. Why are you doing that? You're wasting my time because tomorrow you will release another song. So you'll brand another. You don't know if you Kingwana How or Joe Kim Hall. So you have to bring two t-shirts now. What's wrong with that? You don't do brand. Don't brand. Just work at it. Jesus did not even brand himself.
Mm.
It's what he does that talks.
You're
more than the branding. So you find a lot of people have the branding. The branding is beautiful, but when you bring them in terms of delivery, they deliver nonsense.
Mm.
And you find somebody that is not branded, they come and do amazing job because the content has been taken care of. Young people who are musicians, they should not worry about branding.
Mm.
Music is about a song. So an artist, whether it's Jabba or let's say who's this guy in Jerusalem? Master G.
Master KG.
Master KG, ne?
Yeah.
Master KG, I didn't know him. Well, because I'm older. I didn't know him. But I know him because of the song. As an artist, your obligation is to the song.
Okay.
People know you because of the song. Now, when you get the song and people get to know you, it's important for you to always respect the song.
Okay.
Now, the problem is, artists, they take the space of the song and they make themselves more important than the song.
Yeah.
And they wear dark glasses. Now they are celebrities. They walk in a particular way. Now it's all about them. That's why the next album becomes a flop. Because they didn't pay attention to the songs. The thing that brought them into the limelight is the song.
So the more you grow, you must pay attention to that one thing, that's the content.
Yeah. What made you to be there? That's what we do. In Joy Celebration, we sit with songs, Baba. We criticize the songs we do. We're like, why are we choosing this song? And then we say, okay, this is a song. It's known. Okay, how can we deal with it? Because it's got that thing that connects. And then when somebody comes and try it, and they sing it. Get somebody else, try it. And then we sit there, we're like, okay, this one is doing it better than that one. We choose that one. Nobody comes with their song and sing their song. Sometimes you bring your own song that you've written, but we don't allow you to sing it. Because we want the best person that presents the song to sing the song. Because it's about the song.
Wow.
It's not about us. Everything else follows the song. Wow. So as an artist or as a person, you need to follow the content. Is what you do that's important than you as a person. That is why then, when God created you, he put what you need to do in you. To carry it. That's your king. Your king, your song is your king as an artist. Not you. So you find people putting themselves there. That is why they then start not greeting people, start disrespecting. Masalambili, when they're still hungry, they would go to every interview, hey, please play this for me and stuff. When the song is big, the next time you call them, they don't want to come. They say, your radio station is small, man. I know. Nakiako Metro, whatever. Now it's about them and not about the song. They don't understand how it works. So starting small, work at it. So when you start, this is the thing. When God gives you something to do, he gives you and not other people. So don't expect people to come flocking to what you are doing, to come believing into what you are doing. No. People are created to wait and see as you work at it.
Okay. So they are watching.
They are watching. Just work at it.
If
you persistent and consistent working at it, they start to believe in you. And then they come closer. They're like, okay. They're not supporting yet. They come closer. Down the line, they're like, there's something there. And then they're supporting you. Now, people want to start something and have everybody supporting them, and then they become famous and they have money. It doesn't work like that. Work at it. When we started Joyous, like you mentioned, when we did a show, I remember in PE we had around 11 or 12 people coming to the show.
The Joyous Celebration. The one that
first
we
time. First time in PE, we had around 11 people. When we went to Cape Town, we had around maybe 10, 15 people coming to the show. You know what we did? We sat down, Lindelani Mtunes and myself. We say to the crew, look, there's like 10, 12 people. Each one represents 1,000. Let's go and sing for 12,000 people. We gave them a show of their lives.
So you treated that those 12 as though there were 12,000.
Oh, yes.
So you don't reduce your performance to the number.
No, you don't. That's why I was saying, if I've got one person listening to me, I'm going to give my heart to that one person. Huh. I won't be like, it's one person, so... No, you give, like you're giving to God himself.
Mm.
When I talk to you today, I need to talk to you. The rest of your day, you should be thinking about what I was saying.
Mm.
That's giving my heart where I am.
Mm.
So we did that. Mm. And today when we go to PE, there's no venue that can carry the audience of Joyous. That's why all over the country, it's sold out shows.
Mm.
It's not because we are lucky. Mm. We work at it. For the first five or six years, no one was getting paid.
Really?
No.
So for 5 years, no salary, no income, nothing?
No.
But you still continue?
We paid the singers. You know? I think it was in Joyous 4 or so. I don't remember what in the early stages where we got the money from the gay takings, and then we sit all of us like this. I had a box, a shoe box.
Mm.
The money was in there. So I give this one 10 rand, 10 rand, 10 rand, 10 rand, 5 rand, 5 rand, 20 rand, 20 rand. Everybody got around 250 rand, everybody. Mm. So we all go home. When it's time for lunch, I go buy bread and poloni, and we mix juice. I cut the bread, I give to them. I remember when we were doing Joyous 3, we did not even have a uniform.
Mm.
So I went and borrowed the graduation gowns from some college. And I went to some Indian shop. I bought some colorful material.
Okay,
I cut it into strips. They put it over here. That was the uniform. We were working at it.
Mm.
So we build until, when you go check Joyous 4, the sleeve, you will see, it's those black gowns. We borrowed them.
And so there were no excuses.
Exactly. No excuse. The biggest thing was that we wanted to sing. That's the thing. We wanted to sing.
Mm.
So what was on the inside is to sing.
Mm.
So we will sing whether there's an audience or no audience. We will sing whether we have uniform or no uniform. We will sing whether we have food or no food. We will sing because it's the singing that God has put in us. Mm. Once you start complaining and say, okay, funding or whatever, you don't know what was put in you.
Mm.
Do business with no funding until funding comes.
Mm.
You don't need funding. Funding needs you.
So when the sponsor, because now you are MTN Joyous Celebration, which stage of your, I don't want to say your life, but as a choir, at which stage did you attract the sponsor?
We started at Joyous 4. To attract a sponsor. That was MTN. Mm. Because when we are at Joyous, because when we started this, now we did not even plan to do Joyous 2, 3. We wanted to do one show.
Really?
Yeah, we just wanted to do one show.
Mm.
What made us start was when we voted and Mandela, and then we wanted to do a show to say thank you to God for that.
Mm.
And we wanted to call it Joyous Celebration. That was one show. Mm. We did it at Vets Theater, Adverts Great Hall. That's it.
Mm.
And people were calling in and saying, when are you repeating this thing?
Mm.
We want another one. Guys, you need to do another one. Because on the first one, we called Sibongile Khumalo, there was Sharon D, we called Benjamin Dube was there, we called a few others.
Mm.
And the group called Family Factory was also there, Bo Vic and Libo Margaret, we did that.
Mm.
People were like, no, guys, you need to do this again.
Mm.
And when you sit there the following, you're like, how are you going to do this? This is expensive.
Mm.
We continued to plan and plan and plan, and then we went and went to Unilever, and we asked for money to do this. They said, no, we don't have money. I remember there was a time we got money from, I'll tell you now, I don't remember which company, they gave us 30,000.
Mm.
That was the first sponsorship we got.
Mm.
Or it was Excel or something like that.
Mm.
So we were able to buy food for the crew and stuff, and we did that.
Mm.
Joyous 3 now, people are like, yeah, no, we can't wait for next year.
Yeah.
Dude, next year. That's where we got the gowns, ka Joyous 3. We went to Durban and we tried to do this. What we did now, when we started Kokobo Joyous 2, 3, we went to churches and said, guys, give us your worship teams. We went to do auditions and do a worship team that will travel. And Joyous was based like that.
Mm.
A big worship team formed by different worship teams from churches to go do shows all over the place. And Bafundisi, the pastors were like, no, you can't take our people. These are our people, you know. So we left them. We advertised in the streets. Got them in. Then we got singers. We did Joyous 3. Now, we recorded
that. So you took it out of the church. And it still became successful outside the
church. Yes. Churches were like, are they even saved? I know. We want to hear their testimony, you know. We don't have time for testimony. There's something burning on the inside. So we left them with their testimony. We went, and then we did Joyous 3. We took that, packaged that. We went to MTN, talked to MTN. MTN got on board. So we're able now to do Joburg, we did Bloemfontein, we did, I think, Cape Town with that limited funding. And MTN went away also. They came 1 year, they left. We packaged that MTN presentation, we went to other people. Then there was Metropolitan who came on board. We did Metropolitan for a couple of years. They're like, now we're out of here. And then we get to National Ports Authority. They gave us 2 years also. You know, and then we ended up going Old Mutual. They gave us, I think it was 3 or 4 years.
Old Mutual Joyous.
Yes. It was difficult to announce on, because I'm the one that speaks. Imagine. I remember one day when I said, I called it what? Oh Lord, I called it something else. And Kom Rao in the choir, Lindelan was like, hi, word. and then after Old Mutual, MTN came back again.
Okay.
Now we're going to about 14 years now with MTN.
Wow.
Because now they see the irresistible packaging of this entity.
Irresistible packaging.
That's the thing.
So you must package yourself in a manner that will make you irresistible.
When you do a presentation, you don't do a presentation that says, I need you. You do a presentation that says, you need me. I've got this reach.
Okay.
I reach so many people. And this is how these people are. I mean, go MTN and other places. When you want to see young people going crazy, come to Joyous. Straight, gay, young, old, you find
everybody.
You find a person that was introduced to Joyous when they were 5 years. Coming to Joyous now, they are 25. They bring their 5-year-olds and their parents. There is no show that presents anything that attracts that type of generations in one show. And when you sit and listen, like, I need them. You understand? But we worked at it from the beginning when we're not even aware what we're doing. This is the thing. When you start small, you don't even know that you're starting. You don't even know what you're doing. But there's something.
It's good to start even when you don't know what you're doing.
Yeah, boo. You don't need to know. When God puts something in you, go do it. You don't need to know what it is. God does not tell you, because this is the thing. If God was saying, was going to come to us and say, guys, I need you to start your celebration. You know, this thing is going to go for 25 years or for 30 years, and it's going to be all over the world. You will record in the Potter's House in Texas, Dallas. You will be going all over the world doing whatever. We would go and start to do it with pride, but with no content. You understand? And when you go to people, you're like, no, you must give us money, because you know, Tina, we are big, we are going to record overseas. But record what? What is the content? No content. So God hides that from you in order for you to fiddle. To fiddle. That is why even gold and diamond, God puts it under the ground so that you fiddle until you get it. So even if you don't know, do it. Whatever you feel driven to do, do it and work at it. Don't be discouraged that people don't understand it. Don't be discouraged that people don't support you. Don't be bitter. They can't support you. It's not their thing. It's your thing. Do it to an extent that they even see down the line.
Since we're on that one, there are some people that are saying, I'm discouraged now at the stage of my life. I will no longer do it because my community, where I come from, the people that I'm expecting support from, they don't support me.
Don't expect. The community owes you nothing.
Okay.
The whole world owes you nothing. You owe them, actually, by creating something that they've never seen before so that it will make their lives better. You owe them that. If you're going to open up a car wash in Soshanguve,
open up a car wash that can't be resisted. And people will think, why is this thing not created? Why did we have to wait until now to see something like this? To see people washing cars like this? To get a service like this? Do it. But don't expect people to support you. It's your thing. It's not their thing. When this thing becomes successful, all the money goes to you. You won't. This is the thing. If you do something and expect the community to support you, when you become successful, pay the community. You understand? So as long as all the money that would be made here goes to you, don't expect them to support you.
Okay.
Offer them something they can't resist. Something that will make them go to their pockets. Then when you take the money and use it alone with your family, you don't even feel guilty. It's yours. You worked at it. But if you start it and they come and they work at it on your behalf, when the money comes in, it should go to them too. So work at it. Work at it. Even if you need the agonizing moments where you are disillusioned and confused about it. When I left my I was a lecturer at college, and I left to come and start Joyous full time. I told my wife, look, I'm leaving. I'm resigning from college. I'm going to Joburg to start the music industry. I did not know what I was coming to do. What I knew is that I don't want to be here. With a degree, with prestige, with the people respect me and stuff. But I knew I do not want to be here anymore. There is more that God has given me. And that more on the inside is calling me away from this place. So I told my wife, I'm leaving. I'm going to Joburg. I'm resigning. Tomorrow I'm going to resign. And my wife looks at me. I'm like, I didn't explain anything. I started writing a letter. In the morning, I delivered the letter. And they say to me, no, don't resign. You can put an application for what they call the severance package.
Okay.
You'll get enough money to pay up your house and have my little money left for you. And then you can leave. I'm saying to them, I'm leaving now. I can't wait 3 months. I need to leave now. What was on the inside was chasing me away from this place that is not aligned to what was on the inside. So I left. The next morning I was driving. Let me tell you this. It's in the book. I'm driving. Oh, Richards Bay. I used to stay in Richards Bay. I'm driving. And halfway, I'm asking myself, I left my job. I left an opportunity to get money to pay up my house and stuff. Where am I going to live today, to sleep today? I had no place to sleep on that day. Let alone where I was going to stay in my whole period when I'm in Joburg. No, I did not have a place to stay on that day.
And that time you're with your wife.
I'm alone. I left my wife. I get told her I'm resigning. I'm going to Joburg. I leave my wife and my kids. So I drive to Joburg. I don't know where I'm going to sleep today. I do not know what I'm going to do in Joburg. I do not know anything. All I know is that the thing on the inside is showing me this direction. So I drove until I entered Joburg. When I entered Joburg, I'm like, where am I going to sleep today? And I remember the guy I had met at some production here, Gospel Gold, or something here, or SABC. So I give him a call. I'm like, hey, what's up? I was not close. It was not my... It's a guy I met. I thought, I'm sharp. Yeah, man. So, so I go to his house. So he's watching TV with his brother. I sit there. And in my mind, I'm thinking, this is going to be interesting. So fast forward, I stayed in that house for 8 months.
Yeah.
Sleeping on the couch, two-seater couch. I'm long. When you're tall like me, you are long. So I sleep on the couch. So the owner of the house is his brother. So I tell the guy, look, man, things are like lala segu late. And then he says, okay, sharp. He throws a blanket.
But you already knew the intention from the beginning.
It was not even an intention. It was not an intention to stay there for 8 months. I just wanted to sleep on that day. Then I will see the next day. That's another thing. When you're starting small, focus on the thing that is in front of you. Forget about the next day. Forget about the next thing. Focus 100% on what is in front of you. Give it 100%. So I slept on that couch. And then when I wake up in the morning, I take the guy
to go do breakfast. We do breakfast, and then we drive around, we sit down, and then I talk to him. I'm like, yo, I'm Zokalum music lana in.
Mm.
And we you know, we connect as friends. You know, he kind of likes me.
Mm.
You know, in the afternoon we go back to the house. And then when it's time to sleep, the brother goes to his bedroom and he throws a blanket to me.
Mm.
We did that for 8 months.
Wow.
Until after 8 months, Joyous has been registered, things are starting to show up, and I've got my gigs. That's where I started collaborations with Vuyo Mokoena. We did some gigs. Then I was able to come out of that house and rent another house of my own.
Mm.
Stayed there. And things were coming together nicely. We were on Joyous 4, we're going to Joyous 5. Then I was able to buy a townhouse.
Mm.
But the biggest thing is work at what is in front of you 100%.
Okay.
How do you work at that? Work at that to an extent that no one can come and do better.
Okay, okay.
What you have done should be in such a way that no one can do better.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is the thing. During the time when I was, I think I was in, when I first, when I moved from this guy's place, I rented my own place. It's the place where I bought a small keyboard.
Mm.
And I bought books that teach music.
Mm.
To teach a chord of music, how, or chord C, chord D. I would sit there because I had nothing else to do.
Mm.
So I worked at the music.
Mm.
Many of my songs were written there.
Mm.
Ne?
Mm.
Number two, what I did was to sit with a tape recorder.
Mm.
Tape recorder. I would read a newspaper and record myself.
Mm.
So I can hear how I speak English.
Okay.
I was preparing myself for a stage in my future where I have to speak to people.
Mm.
When I speak to people, people can hear what I'm saying. I have a command.
Mm.
But it's not a natural thing. I worked at it.
Mm.
I would listen to what I've recorded, like, I don't speak like people who speak good English. And then I would take a magazine and read the article.
Mm.
In Birmingham in 1984, and then I played that back and listen. It's still not. Oh, international.
Yes, sir.
International.
Okay.
Okay, or international. What do they say? So when I sit and watch TV, I listen to how the words are spoken by the English speakers. This is how they say it. And then I go back to my tape recorder.
Mm.
I say it, I record myself.
Mm.
And I go back and I listen. I'm like, this is better. Then I start standing in front of the mirror, delivering speeches, talking to people. In my head, I had crowds listening to me.
Mm.
From saying, hi, my name is Jabu Hlongwane. Hi, my name is Jabu Hlongwane. Hi, my name is Jabu Hlongwane. I rehearsed that in front of the mirror. And I walk around in my bedroom, in my lounge, in my kitchen as I cook. I walk around and I'm delivering a speech and I'm talking to people. That is working at it.
Mm.
When I sing, I sit and I sing. I sing like I'm singing for a crowd. I see a crowd in front of me, singing in my house, singing all alone with no audience. I am working at it.
Mm.
That is why when I get on stage, I work also at the. This is the thing. I wish somebody that is listening could do this. Go home and go and define who you are.
Mm-hmm.
Who are you?
That's number one.
Not what you do.
Mm.
A whole lot of people, when you ask them who you are, they talk about what they do.
Mm.
Who are you? You need to know yourself, Hore. Am I beautiful? Am I lookable? Do I look attractive or not? You need to know that.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And what is your best feature?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know my best feature is my height.
Mm-hmm.
I've got height. I've got a body.
Mm.
You understand? Mm. You need to use what you got.
Mm.
So when you're a woman, you look pretty in the face. Use that. You need to use that when you work at it.
Mm.
Use that. When you know, and also look at those positive things and look at the negative to say, what are my weak spots, my weaknesses?
Mm.
Or there's what they call SWOT analysis. You look at those things to say, I'm shy. Mm. For instance, you have no idea how shy I was. Mamel, I mean, I come from a family that has 7 kids. I'm the fifth. When they talk and joke and bakwarana and stuff, mina will be sitting down in the corner because I was shy. But in that process, I would take a telephone directly
directly. You see the yellow pages.
Yeah.
I would be reading the yellow pages. From A, read the yellow pages, read the yellow pages. I would read the map of the world. You know, I would know who in the map of the world, Kuruman is this side. Soviet Union is that side. On my own. And when my brother was doing, I think they called it Form 3. I don't know, it's standard what now. They read Macbeth. Now I was in standard 3. So when he puts down his book, yeah, Macbeth, I would start reading Macbeth. There was a time when I was discussing Macbeth with my brother who was in high school.
Wow.
But the shyness, I turned it around to focus on books. So books gave me information that others don't have. When I throw the information to them, they respect me. Then I gain the confidence.
Wow.
You understand?
Wow.
So you can turn around what might be your weakness. Turn it around. And it can be your strongest point in your life. Right now I go on stage, people see this confident person. I was not born like that. I worked at it. So the biggest thing when you start small, work at it. There are many ways of working at it. Work at it and build that, turn it around. It helps you. When you reach your zenith, when you reach the top, you are able to maintain that. That is why as an artist, you don't go down. You're always at the top because you got the muscle. When you're working on it, the muscle was being trained to sustain the glory when God puts you where you're supposed to be.
Sustain the muscle.
So a lot of people want this glory and they can't sustain it and it kills them. That's why they go into drugs. They're famous now. They're making money. They go into drugs. You know, they go into lifestyle that is destructive because they don't have the muscle. If the glory and the being known and whatever money that I have means nothing to me. You will never find me behaving like a celebrity. Because I worked at it. I worked at this. When I'm known, there's work that I put in. So that is why when I meet somebody in the streets who knows me, whether from TV or whatever, that person is very important for me because I worked at it. But when you have not worked at it, you think you are better than a person who is sweeping in the mall. You think you are better than a person who packs groceries at the shop. You think you are better because you have not worked at it. The muscle to hold the fame or the money is not there. You go into drugs, you go into relationships that are bad, you go to decisions that are terrible because you don't have the muscle, because you do not work at it. So starting small is focus on that 100% work at it. When a person works here, works with you, they are here on time. They are prepared all the time. They treat this as an altar. When you switch on the machines, to you, it should be, this is my altar. I am bringing my sacrifice here. You regard this as that. When you do that, God rewards you hundredfold. This is my, I'm doing a sacrifice here. This is my altar right now. There is nothing that I will leave this place without having been said. I'm giving you my all because this is my altar.
I hear you.
God respects that. It's not about me. It's about what I'm sent to say, what I'm sent to do. My job is to provoke you, even irritate you, to your greatness. You may not like what I'm saying. As long as you will move to your greatness, then I've done my job.
Wow. And I believe we can go on and on and on and on and on and on and on. As I said in the beginning, family, today in the studio, we are graced with a great wealth of wisdom. I'm learning a lot and I can see number of comments on Facebook. Yo, so many comments, so many comments. How I so wish I could go through all of them. But I see Bongan also commented and he's saying, I'm watching and it's my birthday. So this is a birthday present to Bongane. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Bongane. Bongane.
Did you hear that, Bongane?
Bongane. Happy birthday, man.
Yeah, happy birthday to you, Bongane. Number of comments, I also wish I can read. But I also see one of our listeners, he always tunes in, Simon Mukwebo. Shout out to you, my brother. Thank you for tuning in. And I also see a comment from my lovely wife. This one, I have to read it. So it goes like this.
Oh, yeah.
She says, so true. when watching Bollywood movies or soapies, you can be rest assured that there will be no kissing, touching, etc. And the women are always fully dressed. She was commenting to what you were speaking about.
They have an agenda.
Yeah, about Dubai.
Yes.
And you know, the other day I was also going through my thoughts, trying to imagine Chinese.
Mm.
Chinese, they have that image that belongs to them. Mm. The way they dress,
absolutely,
it's constant.
Yeah, they have an agenda to say, their identity is solid.
Mm.
They know who they are.
Mm.
You understand?
Mm.
The problem with us, particularly in South Africa, we do not know who we are.
Mm.
So we just become whatever that comes.
Mm.
You know, when we know who we are, the other nations, they will put laws in place without caring what other people say.
Mm. Mm.
Runa, we can't even put...
Because we don't want to hurt anyone.
That's the thing. We want to be nice guys.
South Africa.
Our government, we can't say something and stand with our 2 feet firm on it. Because we wait. DA will criticize us, you know? And people will criticize us on social media. If you know, as a leader, you can't lead from the people.
Okay.
That is why democracy is not a biblical thing.
Okay.
Democracy is not biblical.
Yeah.
That is why it doesn't work.
Democracy. Did you hear that, Fabian?
Like, for real. I mean, it says in Tando Yening, it says the majority rules. It doesn't matter what the majority says. If the majority says we kill our children, if it's 51%, we all have to kill our children. That's rubbish. So the democracy system is not biblical. It's not godly, even.
Mm.
So we are afraid to offend.
Mm.
That's another thing. As a leader, you are called to go into the future where you're supposed to lead people and come back and lead them to where you've been.
Mm.
Because you can't lead people to where you've never been. That is why many are the afflictions of the righteous. Ne? Mm. In this world, you will experience trouble.
Mm.
But the biggest thing that he says, I have conquered it all.
Mm.
Jesus went and did it and conquered and seen it. Mm. So he comes back to tell us that this is what you're going to experience.
Mm.
But you can't be a leader and lead from hearing what they want.
Mm.
You don't lead people to where they want to go.
Mm.
You lead people to where they're supposed to go.
Okay.
You can't lead. So the democracy says people should vote where they want to go. People don't know.
Mm, mm.
People don't know. Yesterday they were supporting Inkatha, they're supporting ANC. Now they are EFF, they're on DA. They don't know.
Mm.
That's why you need a leader.
Mm.
That will tell them, yeah, banna, reako.
Done.
If you don't like it, hard, it's a matter of like a taxi driver. You got people in the taxi. You need to know where you're going. You can't be sitting down and say, guys, where do you think we should go? You can't.
Mm.
People get into a taxi that has a driver that knows where they are going.
True.
So you say, Kiyakoso Shanguve, section what and what and what, you know where you're going.
Mm.
So people align themselves with where you know you are going.
Mm.
So this democracy says you should go ask people. It doesn't work like that. So you need to know. So when we need to know that we want to create an Africa, a South Africa, that has values that are based on our culture.
Okay.
We need to do a law that says our culture does not disrespect women.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
so if you create a movie or an advert that shows any inkling of disrespecting women, we ban it.
Mm.
Songs, for instance, there's a song, for instance, Cyril Ramaphosa is closing down liquor. But on SABC, Zambia is releasing a song which is a hit that talks about drinking and getting drunk.
Mm.
Then it's not a systematic way of doing things. If we're closing liquor, let's close liquor whether people complain or not.
Mm. Mm.
Because if we open liquor, people die. There's gender-based violence, there's car accidents. Close the damn liquor. Close it.
Mm. Fathers don't even sleep at home.
You understand? So you need to, as a leader, close it.
Mm.
Let them complain.
Because
you know that your job is to save lives. Your job is to save women. Because you have seen that when liquor is open, this happens. You need to have a resolution to say we are closing. It doesn't matter if people complain. That's leadership. But if your leadership is based on the amount of noise that people make, just like a parent at home, you can't lead as a parent based on what your kids want. No, you can't. You have to be resolute and say, this is what happens in this house. In my house, this is what happens.
Done.
That is why in China is so solid. Dubai is so solid. In other nations, I mean, it's a crazy thing. When you listen to radio, we hear music from America more in South Africa. When you go to America, you hear music from America. You understand? When I was in Cameroon, and I was in Kenya, luckily they still play their music. A lot of their music. But South Africa, you listen to radio. When you go overseas, in the US particularly, you watch TV, it's so boring. Because they have the same stuff that we have on TV in South Africa. We take America and put it on our TV and hope that we will maintain our identity. Americans have Americans in their TV. They don't have anybody else. When you listen to American radio, you won't hear your song, Baba. No African song, no nothing. Joyous. There is no joyous. They don't care. They play their music. Runa, in our radio, we play their music. Almost 100%. It's crazy. That is why we don't, even our how we look according to what we see Americans do on TV. Because our TV is like it's owned by Americans. You know? So when a person comes and speaks like an American, we look up to them like, wow. You know? When you speak like an African, you speak... That's why I like Nigerians there. They will speak and break that English. They don't
with
care.
With their own accent.
Yeah, they don't care. Because they know who they are. I was sharing on Sunday, Hori, I was watching the United Nations. There's Olusegun Obasanjo. When he was still president. My goodness. When they walk into the auditorium and they're wearing suits, he would be wearing that African Nigerian thing. I don't know what they call that attire. He'd be walking around throwing it over his shoulder like that. Then he sits there. He's the only one. Everybody knows that's African. Everybody knows that Nigerian. The identity is solid. So now we want to look like everybody. When you're wearing your traditional stuff, they're like, are you going to a function? That is crazy. We have an Africa Music Week or the Africa, where our music is played
Heritage
for 1 week.
Band.
Yeah, we play our music for a week and stuff. That's crazy. We do not have an identity. We do not strive to have our identity as African. We look down upon our identity. Now, this look at this one. We look down upon who we are as Africans. That is why we look down upon what we have as individuals. Because we are in the habit of looking down on what we have. When God puts something on you, no matter how powerful, you will look down on it because it's yours. That is why now they come and they take the shweshwe material and create clothes. The Chinese, they take the shweshwe material, they take the Lesotho blankets. They do a twist on it and they sell them to us.
They're branding it well.
They brand it well. They do something nice about it. We all go and buy it. Look up on... It's not ours anymore. But when we still had it, we did nothing about it because we look down upon what we have.
Yeah.
There's a lot of work that needs to be done about us. You know, we have Tswane, but there's nothing Tswane about it. This town is run by white people. This country is run by white people. As we sit here, they're sipping wine and drinking coffee in coffee shops. The town, the city is making money for them. And the people who are actually food soldiers who are making the money is black people. And in Runa, we are relaxed. Riavota, ANC, DA, AFF. That's all a waste of time. White people are not bothered about ANC. White people are not bothered by EFF. They're not bothered by anything as long as they run the money. You can run the government. They run the money. They run the country.
Yeah. It is now 20 minutes past 12. I think our time overlapped with 20 minutes. So I think we'll just wrap up maybe for 5 minutes or 10 or so. So before we can even sign out, Pastor. Oh yeah.
Overload.
I'm
sorry.
Because psychology wise, it's information overload.
We need to.
Yeah, that's true.
We need overload of information because there's a lot that needs to be fixed.
That's true.
You understand?
We should have actually planned for 3 sessions for 1 day, for 2 days.
Maybe.
Next time we'll do so.
Yeah.
So before we can even wrap up, I want to ask you the following question. What do you want to be remembered for?
I don't want to be remembered.
Mm-hmm.
There is no intention on my side to be remembered.
Mm-hmm.
All I'm doing is do what I need to do, 100%, and then die.
So,
the problem
yours is to be relevant now.
Not relevant. Because when you do what you're supposed to do, it does not need to be relevant. Because relevance means now.
Mm.
What you are building might be relevant 10 years when you are dead.
Mm.
Like the power of Jesus Christ went more when he died.
Mm.
So don't want to be relevant.
Mm.
Just somebody was asking me my motto. What's my motto? What drives me? You know?
Yeah.
So I say, is to be all that I can be as soon as I can. All that I can be as soon as I can. That's my motto.
Mm.
To empty myself completely so that I die empty. When a child comes on this earth, he comes like this.
Mm.
It's a symbol of bringing something.
Mm.
I want to die like this, having left everything that I brought. Whether I'm remembered or not remembered, that's not my business. I mean, this microphone's business is not to be remembered. This microphone's business.
Now I hear you.
Is to take my voice, transport my voice to everywhere that's going to be. That's the business of the microphone.
Mm.
So if your focus is to be remembered, you will not do what you're supposed to do now.
Mm. 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 Mm.
So I want to do everything that I need to do now. To the best of my ability.
Mm.
Whatever happens after that is none of my business.
Hmm.
Whether they remember me or not, it's not my business. My job, I have not come here to be remembered. I have come here to be everything that God has put in me to the best of my ability and then exit.
Now, let's talk about, because when I was doing my research, I found out that your church is called Cross Power Ministries.
Mm-hmm.
That's the church that you are pastoring.
Mm-hmm.
And this morning I was going through your album, mm-hmm. and something came to mind, that the title of your album is called Cross Power Experience.
Mm-hmm.
Cross Power Ministries,
mm-hmm.
Cross Power Experience.
Mm-hmm.
Why Cross Power?
God gave me that word, Cross Power, before I recorded Cross Power Experience, before I started church. And when he gave me, I did not know what was it for. So I could not release myself from this word cross power.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was emphasizing the power of the cross.
Mm.
You see, when the negative and the positive meet, they produce power. So the work at the cross was the meeting of our sins with the saving grace of God. And the power was born. I exist because of that. So God gave me that name, Cross Power. I did not know what it was for. So I walked with that name for a long time. Until God said to me, when I recorded my first Cross Power Experience, my live recording. I was carrying that word, that name. So I named the album Cross Power Experience because it was different from Jabu Hlongwane. Jabu Hlongwane is recorded in the studio. It's Jabu alone. When I'm doing the live, I feature other people, but it's recorded live in front of the audience. So I call that Cross Power. I continued with that. And then God called me when I was in my early 20s.
Mm-hmm.
But I ran away.
So you were called.
That's another story.
You heard the voice, yeah. Ran away,
yeah.
Came back.
I don't know. I wanted to go study. I said, God, let me go study before I start ministry.
Mm.
So I went to university. I studied. I also studied biblical studies and stuff. But that's a story for another day.
Mm.
So which is a very important story because it happens to other people too. But this is another thing. When God calls you, he does not say, go now.
Mm.
But Moses, they had to wait for 40 years. But David waited for many years. The mistake is to want to go now when God calls you.
Mm.
God does not call you to go do this now.
Mm.
Jesus was called before he did what he was supposed to do.
Mm.
That is why there's no record of Jesus when he was a baby, even though he was called.
Mm.
So I then sat with this cross-power experience, but I could hear Uguti. I'm not finding peace with naming my live recordings Cross Power.
Mm.
So I ran away to an extent that I even forgot that I was called. and then I recorded Cross Power 2. I thought I had escaped God successfully, you know. But God was the incubation process. You will read about it in the book. Mm. There's an incubation process.
Mm.
So one day I'm sitting at church, Nekiko Grace, Bishop Musa,
mm-hmm.
and this woman comes to me. I've never seen her before. She says, she shows me a verse. I don't even remember the verse, but it was, God says, go and start the ministry he called you for.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, what? So many years later, I thought God had forgotten. So then the following week, I avoided going to Grace because I don't want to meet that woman. Because I knew what she was saying. So I went to some church. I'm like, I told my wife, I'm going to visit some church. So I drive. I go past Go Gracie. Go. And I call somebody. I had seen some pastor, go social networks, Pastor Gameta or something. I heard his church is in Midland. But they give me directions. I go there and then I sit down there. I'm a visitor. And then they called me to the front. I forgot that I'm known.
Oh.
So in churches, they will not allow you when they know you to sit at the back. So I refuse, and it becomes a little scene. I'm like, I go, I sit at the front somewhere. And then the pastor stands up and then he wants to start. He doesn't see me. He starts the service and he says, yo, wasn't it telling you to go to the and whatever. And then he looks to the side and says, how? You are here. This is Jabu Hlongwane. You are here. We are glad to see you. And then he continues. And then he stops midway. He says, please come here. And he says, please greet Abazalwane. So I greet Abazalwane. Then before I sit down, he holds me, on my shoulder. He says, you, unfortunately, look, I don't know you. I know that you're Jabu Hlongwane, you're a gospel singer, but I don't know you. Like, I don't know anything about you. But God says you need to start a church.
Mm.
And in 6 months, this is supposed to happen. In 9 months, this is supposed to happen. In 9 months, he says, you're supposed to be ministering in the U.S. in 9 months. Mm. And he talks. And then he says, God did not call you for music. He says, I should tell you that. You know? So, fast forward. I went and wanted to register for theology in Cambridge in the U.S. And God says, don't study. Go to ministry.
Mm.
I'm like, okay. So I come back, I go to UNISA, go to theology department.
Mm.
I sit with the professor there. I'm like, this is my situation. I want to study part-time. I will start the ministry, but I want to study part-time. Because my thing wanted to be a professor. I like education. So he listens to me. He's an old man. He says, look, I'm retiring this year.
Uh-huh.
I've seen a lot of callings dying at university. When God has called you, he has equipped you. Go into ministry. Don't study. So I walked disappointed from that professor into my car. And I'm driving back to Joburg. I've never preached continuously in my life. Now you expect me to start a church and preach every Sunday.
Mm.
I started the ministry.
because I'm scared of God. When God says, I did not call you for music, he might close the music thing, you know? So I go start the ministry. In the ministry, I was preaching 3 times a week without fail, every week. Mm. I always had something to preach about. And he said to me, this is another thing, don't listen to other people's sermons. Mm. Don't read books. Read the Bible only. So for the first 5-6 years, I was reading only the Bible. I didn't listen. When the sermon is on radio, I switch it off. When it's on TV, I switch it off. For a good 6 years, I was doing that. But when I started, God said, this name is for the church. Mm-hmm. So it became Cross Power Ministries. Mm-hmm. I had used it for the music, which was good because it was not something that is over on the other side. Mm, it's part of the ministry. Mm. But it was called, God gave me that name for the church. Mm. So Cross Power Ministries and Cross Power Experience are related. But the name Cross Power Ministries, Cross Power, was for the church. Okay. But I'm also doing church. That is why if you see me minister now through music, mm-hmm. after I started church, mm-hmm. I do it differently. Because it's a combined thing now. It works together. So when I minister through music, you will hear church in there. Mm. In a big way. Mm. So it's one thing. Mm. That's how it came about.
Mm. I heard even one song you were saying, we are not here to entertain you. This is church.
Yeah.
If you get entertained, it is by mistake.
That's how it is.
Yeah.
That's how it is.
So before we sign out, this is your book. I love the cover. It's beautiful. It speaks to my heart.
Thanks.
Yeah. The title of the book, Finding Meaning in the Journey of Life. And I believe that things that we were discussing about, as you were busy pointing and quoting, that it's also in the book. Mm-hmm. It's also in the book. It's also in the book. And to people now who have tuned in, and they want to have a copy of the book. Of course, you brought a number of copies because we ordered them. We have our own copies, family. Make sure you also get yours. So for those who want to get a copy, where can they go to get a copy of this book?
info@joyous.co.za.
Okay. We'll write that on our Facebook.
Yeah.
info@joyous.co.za. That's where they can place the order. Yeah. Okay. So we're going to sign out. Before we can sign out, give us your closing remarks.
My goodness. Yeah. It's been great. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. So the book is called Finding Me.
Me.
Yes.
Yeah, I see the me. It's
meaning, but me, finding me. Mm. Because the biggest dilemma is not finding ourselves.
Mm.
We live in a world that takes who we are from other people. You know, the hairstyle I have, I saw it somewhere. The clothes I'm wearing come from somewhere. The way I walk comes from somewhere. The way I speak, you don't find yourself.
So the biggest project itself.
Self. To know self. When you know self, nothing will derail you.
Mm.
And knowing selves talks about closing off others. I like the song that says Likunutung Limurena.
Yes.
You need a Likunutung with yourself. Where you are able to, you know, there are people who can't live in a space where there's no noise. Because they're afraid of finding themselves.
I once met a student who said, I can't read where there's no noise.
Yes. You understand? You need to go to places where you can find yourself and know yourself. It's a topic for another day. Know yourself to an extent that you can know that I am a jealous person. I can't stand people succeeding. You need to know that about you. Because if you don't know that about you, it exhibits itself in unfortunate places where you even become jealous of your partner or your husband or your wife. Because you did not know that about yourself. Because when you know that about self, you are able to manage that and work at that. So my prayer is that everybody develops a hunger to find themselves. Because if you find yourself,
it will be easy for you to even find God. Because when you know yourself, you will be able to know God. Because God and yourself are not one thing. I like Isaiah when he says, "Oh, to me, because I have lips." He sees himself in the light of the presence of God. So knowing yourself, you need to, he's a prophet. He says, as a prophet, he says, my lips need fixing. He's a prophet and his job is to speak the things of God. And he says, my lips need fixing. He knows, he is recognizing himself truly. Therefore, the Bible says, when you read that story, an angel comes and he takes a comb and then he bends the lips. Then after that, he becomes an effective conduit of what God wants to say. Imagine if he did not know that his lips are like that. He will be speaking the things of God with lips that don't qualify to speak the things of God. So knowing yourself helps you in order to manage, to cleanse, to expose those things that are not aligned to your destiny, to God.
Okay.
So that when you do what God has called you to do, your purpose, you do that with a cleansed, fixed, aligned self. It's a very big and long kind of thing for a closing remark. But my passion is for people not to be satisfied. Okay, let me put it like this. Are you satisfied with who you are now? Are you satisfied with where you are now? Are you satisfied with what you have achieved now? If the answer is no to all these threes, there is work to be done by you today, not in the future. You need to go to a space of saying, God help me. Because if you were to die today, what report would you give to God? Because nobody has been created to have a car or a house or a husband or a wife or money. No, we are created for greater things than those. If the only thing you will put before God is that, God, I went to earth and I made money, then you missed the point. Or, God, I went to earth, I was driving a big car. There are things that God has created us for, and he put that inside of us. It's those things that won't go away. You need to start working at that. Now, even if you do this when you get home, just pray a prayer. Father, help me to realize the things that you have put in me. The things that God has put to you inside of you, is not many things, it's one thing. That's another thing. God created people for one thing. Everybody has been created for one thing. But there are many things that lead to that one thing. Jesus walking on water, Jesus raising the dead, all those things are moving him to the one thing. So there is your one thing that you are created for. If you pray and say, Father, help me to realize my one thing. Even if I you point me to the direction of my one thing, your one thing will help you to don't waste time on other things. Because that's the thing. The time we are given, I said you are created and the purpose, your thing is put in you and it's wrapped up in time. The time is equal to the journey of the thing. So if you waste time on other people's things, you are taking time from your thing. So even when your thing is activated, you will not have enough time to bring it to fruition. That is why Jesus did not heal every sick person. Others he left like that. He left poor people. Because he knew that the time I have for what I'm supposed to do will not be affected by things that I meet along the way. So if you know your thing and you are aligned to your thing, you are pointed to your thing, you will disregard other things. You don't have to do all things. I can do all things through Christ, but does not mean do all things. I can do all things, but don't do all things, because nobody is called to do all things. So when your thing is provoked and activated, and it's aligned and pointed to the direction of your seat of glory, like Jesus and his cross, along the way, things will happen and you will disregard them as you pursue that, because the time you have on this earth is equal to your journey to your seat of glory. Once you waste your time, a lot of people have ended halfway through their journey. Great people, like Miles Monroe says, the graveyard is the most richest place because there are billionaires and millionaires who did not become millionaires because they did not know You know, they just lived their life anyhow. So they did not make those. So they went into the grave with the potential for millions because they ended halfway, because they were busy doing other things. And other people get into the pocket of destinies of other people. So because you do not know where you're supposed to do, what you're supposed to do, where you're supposed to go, you don't know your thing. You end up jumping to other people's things and pushing the agenda of other people's things. When you die, you've done nothing. Because there are people that are waiting to sebenza nawe, but they can't sebenza nawe because you are sebenzing with other people. Your time is wasted with you working with other people. And there are people that are put in place by God to join and work with you, to help your destiny. But you are busy helping other people's destiny because you don't even think that you have a destiny. You don't even think that you have anything that God has given you. I pray that people don't sleep tonight. If you hear this, don't sleep. I pray that the Spirit of God worries you in your bones that you don't sleep until you go to your destiny.
Yes.
Until you go to God and say, Father, reveal to me what I need to do. Because nobody has been born fearfully created and wonderfully made by God for what you have achieved so far.
Sure. Those are closing remarks upon closing remarks upon closing remarks. I can see even reactions on Facebook. People are liking what you are saying. Maybe we're supposed to schedule this one in the beginning. It's powerful, powerful. So there are a number of things which I took for myself. Of course, this ones, I'll go with them. Packaging, it's very much important. I'll make sure even this radio station, it's well packaged. Number two, do it. Do it. When you have a vision, make sure you do it. The next one, number three, work at it. And I like it when you spoke about muscle consistency.
Yeah.
Because sometimes when we get there, we also start to relax because we are receiving praise.
Mm-hmm.
And you forget that for you to continue looking the way you look, you must continue putting in efforts, work day in, day out.
Mm-hmm.
And then the fourth one, you also spoke about irresistible. Make sure that your thing becomes irresistible.
Mm-hmm.
And then, the last word. When you do it today, forget about the next day.
Yeah.
Give it your all today.
Yeah.
And that's what you said to me in the beginning before we started with the interview. You said you will do it as though today was your last day.
Mm-hmm.
And of course you did it. We're supposed to finish at at 12. Now it's 12:43. It's 12:43. 43. Yes. Actually, this interview went for 3 hours. You broke the record.
Excuse.
No, you're welcome. You're welcome. We'll convert this into a video that will take to YouTube. Of course, we'll have part one, part two, part three.
Yeah.
It's wealth of wisdom for even generation that will come after us. Thanks a lot, Pastor. Really appreciate.
Thank you, sir.
You know, before we can even close, I remember the day when you inboxed me on Facebook.
Yes.
I was like, oh, I'm dreaming. And it was at the beginning of the lockdown. I think it was around March.
Yeah.
And he said to me, I'll get back to you.
Yeah.
And I waited. I think three weeks back, I received the WhatsApp from you.
Yeah.
I was like, can I please verify? Is this the real Jabu Hlongwane?
And I got back to you.
Yeah. I saw for so many ways to verify. Even the profile picture doesn't say it. I was like, okay, maybe I'm being scammed. But I'm glad that finally this day came and we did what we were supposed to do. We sign out, family. There's a song from Pastor's latest album. I hope it's the latest one, because sometimes we say it's the latest and you only find out it's not the latest. I was listening to this song on Saturday, you know, and I soaked in worship. The title of the song is Let It Rain.
Yep.
So is this your latest
project? That's the latest, yeah.
Okay.
Cross Power 3.
So what can people expect after this?
I don't know.
You don't know.
And it's okay not to know.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we want to appear as people who are proper, who know their story. It's okay not to know.
Mm.
Because God has this thing of not giving you the whole agenda.
Mm-hmm.
This is the thing about me. I don't record music when I don't have anything to say musically.
Mm.
I don't release albums every year. I don't release because I can sing.
Mm.
I wait for a pregnancy.
Mm.
I have to be pregnant with the message, with the music.
Mm.
Then I do an album. I can stay for 10 years, not no album. It's fine with me.
Wow.
So I don't know what's next.
You heard that, family. If you're asking yourself what's next, you heard it from Pastor. He doesn't know what's next. But we know what we have now. What we have now is Let It Rain by Pastor Jabu Hlongwane. Enjoy the song as we sign out. Tomorrow, it's Tuesday, we'll be having Multi B on One Day is One Day with Multi B. Please make sure you tune in to that beautiful segment. Hey, I heard that Spirit of God. Let it rain. We are there, family. We are there. Yes. Yes. Actually, people should watch this video. Make sure you go to YouTube. Check the confidence and that assurance that I was talking about. Relax, right?
Let it rain.
Yes.
It's a simple song. You can join me.
Let it rain.
Spirit of God.
Spirit of God.
Let it rain.
Let it rain.
Like a mountain.